successful or made us to be loser. It's not. It's Allah's ilm. Allah knows things in advance, because for Allah, past, present and future does not apply. Allah transcends the time and space limitations. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, everything gonna happen, things happened, and something happening now is as equal as it is present for us, subhanAllah. Then everyone's rizq is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Man has to strive, of course, but his major objective in his life, his aim of life, is not going after wealth, subhanAllah. وَيْلٌ لِكُلِّ هُمَزَةٍ لُمَزَةٍ. Here in this surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is highlighting the point that a believer should have a real healthy mind. He should be emotionally wealthy, and he should be emotionally powerful. He should be mentally and psychically, he should have mental, psychic and emotional strength. In the body language, it's haram, subhanAllah. It's haram to do all these things. And humaza and lumaza. Here, in Arabic, humaza or lamaza, it has its original root word in Arabic that means, hamaza means kasara, to break. Hamaza is to break something into pieces. And here, someone who kasara bin a'radin nas, someone who is breaking people's emotions, subhanAllah. And lamaza is to, the meaning is ta'ana. Ta'ana is to pierce into someone's body. It's really hurting. Similarly, hurting his feeling. So both are same. We come to the Quranic meaning. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu and some of other Mufassirin and Tabi'in got some detailed narration about the meaning of this verse, where some of the scholars says humaza means to hurt someone by his hand, using his power, using his position. And lumaza is ayyab, someone who is hurting other by his tongue. We have to understand the very meaning of Muslim. What is the meaning of Muslim? Al-Muslim, man salim al-Muslimun min lisanihi wa yadi. Wal-Mu'min, man amin al-Mu'minun min lisanihi wa yadi. A believer is a person from whose tongue and hand everybody else is safe. So you think of a man, and you think about him, this man wouldn't say anything bad about me. Oh, he's such a good person. He will not say, though I am wrong, though I did something wrong. He knows that, but he's not going to publicize it. He's not going to tease me. He's not going to hurt me about it. So if he has such a feeling about a person, that means he has a perfect iman. The same, rhetorically, the meaning with Muslim and Mu'min is the same, where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Al-Muslim, man salim al-Muslimun min lisanihi wa yadi. A Muslim is a person from that every believer is safe from his tongue and his hand. His tongue means all of his words, could be verbal, could be written, and where yadihi means his hand, his actions, his power, his gestures, his body language, whatever, in sort of hurting a person. SubhanAllah, a believer is safe. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to say that, لا يؤمن من لا يؤمن جاره بضائقه. He's not a believer that his neighbor cannot be safe from his torturings, from his harms. A believer is a person is not a believer if his neighbor can't be confident of him. Subhanallah. The Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in these two words, Allah says wailun. Wail is the word that means a curse, destruction. Allah has used this word 27 times in Quran. It came in Surah Al-Mursalat 10 times. Wailun yawm idhin lil-mukadhibin. Two of the surahs has the opening starting with wail. Wailun likulli humazatin lumaza. And wailun lil-mutaffifin. SubhanAllah, وَيْلٌ لِلْمُتَفِّفِينَ and وَيْلٌ لِكُلِّ هُمَزَةٍ لُمَزَةٍ. What is the meaning of wail? While it's a curse, it could be a prayer, it could be a constructive sentence, but here when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used the word while in dhikra, which is not starting with al, if it were said like al wailu li kulli humazatil lumaza, al wail, the curse is for every humaza and lumaza, the sentence will be more a statement of facts. Woe to those who have the habit of backbiting and slandering. That will be an explanation of a fact. But where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala started wailun, without al, starting wailun, we call it in Arabic grammar, which is nakira, which is unknown. Wailun likulli humazatil lumaza, it got a richness in the meaning. At the same time, it is a prayer and it is a statement of fact. At the same time, it is khabariya and fi uslub du'a. Uslub du'a'i, there's a prayer. Wailun, who is cursing? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is cursing every slanderer and backbiter. Then Allah says, whose habit is to accumulate wealth and count them every now and then. The same meaning is repeated. وَيْلٌ لِلْمُتَفِّفِينَ. The another surah starting with wail. وَيْلٌ woe to those. لِلْمُتَفِّفِينَ. To the merchants. لِلْمُتَفِّفِينَ. Who, when they are customers, they would take every bit of their rights. When they are sellers, they will be cheating their customers. There also, man is dealing with wealth. Here also Allah is talking, وَيْلٌ لِكُلِّ هُمَزَةٍ لُمَزَةٍ. Woe to those people who accumulate wealth, pile on wealth, and they don't spend it in the way of Allah. They don't either give zakat nor charity. They don't even understand that other poor people have rights in his own wealth. Those sort of people are going to be sent into wail. Where Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu had a narration, Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu as well. Wail is a valley in the hellfire which has the extreme heat of the hellfire, and the hellfire itself, ask Allah, refuse from that. Oh Allah, I cannot bear with this part of my body. I want to get rid of that part because I can't bear it so hot and extremely hot. That kind of position where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talking about munafiqeen, Allah told, إِنَّ الْمُنَافِقِينَ فِي الدَّرْكِ الْأَسْفَلِ مِنَ النَّارِ. Munafiqeen will be in the lowest bottom of the hellfire, which is going to be a severe and extreme and gravest punishment. So such a person, such a place, a position is chosen for those who are accumulating wealth. Why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talking about wealthy? What is wrong in there? For a believer, it could be beneficial. For a non-believer, it is harmful. It's the reason of his total destruction. When a person does not have an objective in his life, when he doesn't have any preoccupation in the life, no genuine reason he's living for, there is no cause of his life he's working for, then a person is causing anarchy in the society. He has nothing to do with. His entire job is collecting money, accumulating money and cheating people. Where Allah talking about mutaffifin, وَيْلٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ لِلْمُتَفِّفِينَ. Taffafa means to reduce, to take, you know, to take away a little by little. وَإِلَى يَوْمِئِذِ الَّذِينَ إِذَا اكْتَالُوا عَلَى النَّاسِ يَسْتَوْفُونَ وَإِذَا كَالُوهُمْ أَوْ وَزَنُوهُمْ يُفْسِرُونَ. سبحان الله. الَّذِينَ إِذَا اكْتَالُوا عَلَى النَّاسِ يَسْتَوْفُونَ. If they are customers and they're going to a seller, they will take every bit of their right. They don't, oh, I want change. You don't have change? Get it in the nearby shop. I will wait for you. He was waiting for one dirham and he bought something of thousands. But he will take every bit of his right. But don't take much. Give the right. They will say this is made of something and it is made of something else. They will cheat them. Subhanallah. They will take every bit of like a round car, where that car normally indicates, you know, feminine gender, but it's not feminine. It also indicates kathra. excess, a lot of. A person whose habit is to slander people, whose habit is to sarcastically harm people, jokes that really hurt, subhanAllah. You know, kind of writing that really hurt people, kind of saying in words that really hurt mu'mineen, believers, there is a big problem. وَيْلٌ لِكُلِّ هُمَزَةٍ لُمَزَةٍ. Slanderer and backbiter. A believer has to control his tongue and his emotions and his actions. So that is the lesson we learn the very first verse of the surah. We have to have control of our tongue and of our actions. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to say that مَنْ يُضْمَنُ لِي مَا بَيْنَ لَحْيَيْهِ وَمَا بَيْنَ فَخِذَيْهِ أَضْمَنُ لَهُ الْجَنَّةِ. If anyone can guarantee me, you know, the thing between his two jaws and that which is between his two thighs, I will guarantee him the paradise. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam indicating one's tongue. If a person can control his tongue and talk only good and speak only good, not hurting people, not hurting their feelings, not breaking anyone's emotions, if you can guarantee your tongue that you will be using that only for the sake of Allah, وَمَا بَيْنَ فَخِذَيْهِ, and that which is in between the two thighs of a man, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was indicating to have the purity in a man's sexual life, to have it done only with his wife. If a person can guarantee he can abstain from adultery, which is a social abuse, إِنَّهُ كَانَ فَاحِشَةً وَسَاءَ سَبِيلًا, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, it is indeed bad and worse, it's a worse sin, وَسَاءَ سَبِيلًا, and it's a wrong path. Subhanallah, then if these two things could be guaranteed, then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is here to guarantee us the paradise. Subhanallah. So, Ibn Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu arallah, he used to say that, Ya Rasulullah, O Messenger of Allah, أَنَحْنُ مُحَاسَبُونَ عَلَى مَا نَتَكَلَّمُ بِي. Are we going to be accountable for the words that we are talking, or just for the actions? Because the logic says, if you do something, that is something you believe you have done a mistake. If you talk, you go talking and talking and talking, you don't know what you're talking about. Then the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they were fresh to Islam. They were learning Islam and asking, oh Rasulullah, are we accountable for all the words we are talking? Are we going to be asked by Allah on the Day of Judgment? Then Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Wayhak, what do you understand? Don't you understand? وَهَلْ يَكُبُّ النَّاسَ عَلَى وُجُوهِهِمْ أَوْ قَالَ عَلَى مَنَاخِرِهِمْ إِلَّا حَصَائِدُ أَلْسِنَتِهِمْ. Don't you understand that Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, that people on the Day of Judgment will be dragged on their faces. Some people will be dragged over their heads towards hellfire only because of the harvest of their tongue. The word is the harvest of their tongue. For those things they have just talked about, they have just spoken about it. Subhanallah, a man, believer, should be very cautious. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, giving an advice to a companion, he used to say, أَمْسِكْ عَلَيْكَ لِسَانِكْ كُفَّ عَنْكَ لِسَانِكْ, control your tongue. That was an advice given to a companion of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Control your tongue. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in another hadith, من كان يؤمن بالله واليوم الآخر, whoever would believe in Allah and the Day of Judgment, فَلْيَكُلْ خَيْرًا أَوْ لِيَسْمُتْ, he should speak only truth or he should be silent. If you have nothing to talk about, you should be silent. Control your tongue. Remember, you know, remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala involved, you know, salam to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You think about Allah, subhanallah, a person has to control his tongue. If only he has something true to speak, let him speak, otherwise let him be quiet. مَنْ كَانَ يُؤْمِنُ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam starting with the statement, whoever believes in Allah on the Day of Judgment, it indicates the seriousness of the case. If you're a true believer, فَلْيَقُلْ خَيْرٌ, a mu'min, a believer should speak only truth, only good. If not, فَلْيَسْكُتْ, let him be quiet. subhanallah. Here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is cursing the people who use their tongue to hurt the feelings of other people. وَيْلٌ لِكُلِّ هُمَزَةٍ لُمَزَةٍ. Woe to those, to every slanderer and backbiter. الَّذِي جَمَعَ مَالًا وَعَدَّدَ. Who accumulated wealth and who goes on counting and counting and counting. It indicates his love of the wealth. Inshallah, we'll come to that. وَيْلٌ لِكُلِّ هُمَزَةٍ. Hassan al-Basri رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ, one of the great scholars of Islam and philosopher, and who was a jurisprudent and a great Islamic faqih and muhaddith. He happened to hear that somebody has backbit him. Someone told bad of Imam Hassan al-Basri radiallahu anhu. Subhanallah, what did he do? He sent a full basket of fresh dates to him, you know, telling his servant, you know, telling him, this is the only one that can compensate you, I have nothing else. So the man was shocked. He was cursing Hassan al-Basri radiallahu anhu, and when he was saying ill of Hassan al-Basri, and he has given him a full basket of dates, some fruits. He asked, why is this for me? Said Hassan al-Basri radiallahu anhu sent it for you as a compensation that he should have received lots of your good deeds. So he has nothing to give in return to you. Subhanallah, this is what happens. If you say something bad of someone, our good deeds are passing to his account. So you may not understand what is going on in our accounts. You know, so Imam Hassan al-Basri radiallahu anhu, he was happy to get that message and told, I can't give you any more good deeds from my account because it's impossible. So I have only these dates, so you may have it and enjoy. He says, I love that. I love to compensate you. You gave something very, very great to me. So I'm compensating, though it is not equal in its size and its price, some compensation. Subhanallah. وَيْرٌ لِكُلِّ هُمَزَةٍ لُمَزَةٍ. Slandering and backbiting. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Hujurat, Allah explained, saying ill of someone is as if eating the dead flesh of your own brother or sister. Subhanallah. أَيُحِبُّ أَحَدُكُمْ أَن يَأْكُلَ لَحْمَ أَخِيهِ مَيْتًا فَكَرِهْتُمُوهُ. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ولا يغتب بعضكم بعضا. You shouldn't be backbiting one another. You shouldn't be backbiting one another. أيحب أحدكم. Do you love أن يأكل اللحم أخي, to eat the flesh of his own brother, ميتا when he is dead. سبحان الله. فكرهتموه. You will of course hate it. You will of course you will like it. You hate it. So the same is the case with backbiting. So every believer has been given rights of his own prestige, his own personality. Allah's Messenger Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam standing on the ground of Arafat, and that was during the time of Eid al-Adha. There Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam announced to the companions, do you know ma yawmukum hada, which is the day today? They were all sure that that was the day of Eid. The day when the believers will rejoice, then they thought Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam will be going to name it with another name. They replied, Allahu wa Rasuluhu alam, we don't know Rasulullah. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he replied, isn't it Eid al-Adha? Isn't it the great day of sacrifice? Where Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam got ready to sacrifice his own beloved son, isn't it Eid al-Adha? Of course, Messenger of Allah. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said the second question, وَمَا شَهْرُكُمْ هَذَا? Which is the month that we are in? That was Dhul Hijjah, the month of Hajj. And companions thought, it is Dhul Hijjah, and why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asking the same question? So should be something new answer will be there. They told Allah wa Rasuluhu alam, we are no Messenger of Allah. Then thereupon, Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replied, isn't it not Allah's Shahrullah al-Muharram? Is it not the most sacred month of Allah, Dhul Hijjah? Yeah, in that month, there shouldn't be any shedding of blood, no fights, no quarrel. Nothing is allowed, no torturing. Subhanallah, isn't that sacred man? Of course, Messenger of Allah. Third question, وَمَا بَلَدُكُمْ هَذَا? And what is the sanctuary, the land we are standing on? Was Haram, the holy sanctuary of Allah, of Mecca. Then they told, repay Rasulullah, Allah wa Rasul alam. We don't know Rasulullah. Then Rasulullah said, isn't it not the Haram, the holy sanctuary? Of course. Then, giving the three important signs, one is the day, the other is the month, the other is the holy shrine, the holy sanctuary of Haram, the place and the time. Witnessing these three, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught, فَإِنَّ أَمْوَالَكُمْ, of course, your wealth, وَدِمَاءَكُمْ, and your blood, وَأَعْرَاضَكُمْ, and your image, your prestige, your personality, your own honor, حَرَامٌ عَلَيْكُمْ, it's haram between you, you shouldn't be tearing them off, you shouldn't be hurting anyone's feelings, you shouldn't be taking anyone's even a single penny, you're not allowed to shed blood, you're not allowed to take anyone's property, no thefts, no stealing, no robbing. وَدِمَاءَكُمْ وَأَعْرَاضَكُمْ عَلَيْكُمْ حَرَامٌ, and your honor is as sacred as the holiness of this month, this place and the day. Subhanallah. Do we really understand? It applies to our wife. It applies to our the husbands. It applies to our brother. It applies to our father and mother, to speak with respect and honor, to speak to them with respect and kindness, to speak with extreme reverence. Subhanallah, that is the model of a Muslim. وَيْلٌ لِكُلِّ هُمَزَةٍ لُمْزَةٍ, he shouldn't be hurting even by a single word. Walid ibn Mughira was a bad person who was the contemporary of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and his habit was to name Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam some nicknames that Rasulullah and none of his companions, no one in the world would love to hear that. There Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded about him in another surah, Abasa wa Basar, he had some different gesture and body language, indicating his condemnation and hatred towards Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imam Fakhruddin al-Razi radiallahu anhu, explaining a lot of things in sequence, more than 20 situations, this may creation to a Muslim brother or sister, to writing to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, pointing to two graves in so and tall, إِنَّهُمَا لَيُعَذَّبَانَ, of course, these two people are being punished in the grave. Subhanallah, these two people are being punished now, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, by the power that Allah has given him in special, he could read that. What did he say? هُمَا يُعَذَّبَانِ فِي كَبِيرٍ, and they're not being punished for really serious, big problems. They're not. In your eyes, that is something really silly and it's nothing. What's that? أَمَّا أَحَدُهُمَا فَكَانَ لَا يَسْتَبْرِئُ مِنَ الْبَوْلِ, one of them was not cleaning himself well after relieving himself. He was not cleaning well after toilets. There were some drops of urine and najasa left over his body, then we're going to pray. So he was not cleaning him. He was not bothered about cleanliness. Subhanallah. Do we think about that? When we use the toilets, could be in public toilets or on travel, or a person who is not keeping himself clean. A believer is clean both inside and outside. And the other person was unclean inside. This person was unclean outside. The other person who is being punished next to him, the other grave. وَأَمَّا الْآخَرُ فَكَانَ يَمْشِي بِالنَّمِيمَةِ, the other person, he used to go with slander. I know him, you don't know him, you don't tell me if I know him. Making, humiliating people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given everyone a protection. Allah is a sattar. Allah is sattar. What is sattar? What is satr means? Satr means curtain. The curtain that's hanging next to the window, that is sadr. Allah is sattar. Allah is putting curtain over your sins. Allah is hiding all your shortcomings. Allah is hiding and protecting all your weaknesses. Then why you go and reveal? Why you go and open it? لَا تَتَبَّعُوا عَوْرَاتِ الْمُسْلِمِ Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to say that. You do not go after every believer's secrets. That is not your business to do. لَا تَتَبَّعُوا عَوْرَاتِ الْمُسْلِمِ You shouldn't go after and you shouldn't be going in minute details and scrutinize what he's doing, what's happening here, what is he talking to, what has come to him, what should I be talking to him. It's none of your business to do that. فَإِنَّهُ And of course, if a person goes on doing that, Allah will be after his secrets. When Allah is going after someone's secrets, يَفْلَحُهُ وَلَوْ فِي قَعْدِ بَيْتِ Allah will humiliate him. Allah will insult him. No matter within the center of his family. SubhanAllah. Then his wife may not be respecting, his children is not respecting, friends are not respecting, no family members are respecting. Why? This person has gone after someone else's secrets, humiliating and backbiting and slandering. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَمَنْ يُهْنِ اللَّهِ فَمَا لَهُ مِنْ مُخْرِمٍ Allah says in Surah Al-Hajj, if Allah wants to insult someone, there will be no one to give him honor. So, backbiting and slandering is a self-teasing. We're losing our good deeds. We are torturing our own mind and our own hearts. And at the same time, we are hurting someone else's feeling. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be insulting that person in this life before the life hereafter. In contrary, Hadith came giving rewards for the people who honor respect and who honor the image, the status of a person. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Man nafasa an mu'minin kurba, nafasa Allahu anhu kurbatan min kurbi yawm al-qiyamah." If a person removes a hardship of a believer in this life, Allah will remove from him hardships of the life hereafter. وَمَنْ سَتَرَ مُسْلِمًا سَتَرَهُ اللَّهُ Whoever hide a believer, Allah will hide him. The meaning of hiding here is keeping his dignity, keeping his status, giving his due honor and respect. SubhanAllah, a believer has to keep that. As Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam declared, the entire rights of humans, فَإِنَّ أَمْوَالَكُمْ وَأَعْرَاضَكُمْ وَدِمَاءَكُمْ عَلَيْكُمْ حَرَامٌ That is the declaration of the human rights. Every person has a right to have honor in this life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ghafoor. Allah is forgiving. Allah is sattar. He is al-latif. He is so kind. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is using all these attributes to give a person his honor. So, we are not allowed in any way to insult any person. If he's a believer, if he said the word of La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah, that is far enough to deserve all the rights that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam announced for every believer on the day of Arafat. Just for a believer. Let him be a drunkard, he's a fasiq, let be anything. Only in a few cases, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave us the exception. Number one is that if a person, I'm asking you about a young man because he wants to marry his daughter to that person. So if he know exactly two things about him, you need to mention. Because that is a basis of a family life. If a good girl who is religiously righteous and good and who has lots of good deeds, we are not to cause someone else to come and spoil her. So we can say any bad of that person just of the intention that you are giving him a pure advice. Number two, if a person is mujahirun bil fisq, a person is fasiq, he does fisq gave a sense in public, doesn't care. He goes on eating and drinking and smoking during the day of Ramadan. Subhanallah. A person whose sins are so public, so you want to warn someone, you don't go and fall in his trap. He is so and so. It could be an advice. You know, you don't want someone to fall in his traps because you know about him. You don't want someone to go astray. You don't want someone to fall into sins. You don't want someone to go into his company. Then you can warn. For the sake of advice, it's not humiliating, but you're telling about him to someone in secret. And finally, if you're witnessing in front of a judge, if you've been asked to bear witness for some incident and you knew it, you can, and you should be saying in front of the judge, and that's all. In all other cases, we have to hide. It's in between the believer and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sayyidina Umar Farooq radiallahu anhu, once he was going around the city of Medina, he happened to see a man who is drunk and he's singing, and it was in the middle of the night. He used to feel, I'm accountable for my people. It's my duty to correct them. Umar radiallahu anhu, he was walking with Abdul Rahman ibn Auf radiallahu anhu. So Abdul Rahman ibn Auf, could you stay there? I'm gonna go and see what's going over there. Umar radiallahu anhu, he couldn't go in because no door was open. He jumped over the fence. He could see a man, there's bottles of wine, and there's a lady next to him, and they're dancing and singing. Subhanallah, Umar radiallahu anhu raised his sword. And he said, O adu Allah, Allah anna Allah yassur anka wa anta ala ma'asiyati. Do you believe that Allah gonna hide all these sins from you? Because you're sinning and it's in Medina and you drank it. Umar Farooq radiallahu anhu, he was going to behead him, and the person requested, stop Umar Farooq, I have a few things for you to say. Though he was a drunkard, he knew some verses of Quran and the rulings of Islam. He said, Umar, that Allah says, لا تدخلوا بيوتا غير بيوتكم ولا تجسسوا ولا يغتب بعضكم بعضا. Do not spy on believers. I was doing that in my compound, and I was doing that, you know, keeping my doors closed. So that was a kind of spy. You spied on me and you came to see what I'm doing. So you have broken three rules. Though as a Khalifa and as a ruler, Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu, he is legally right to do what he has done now. He is not wrong. At the same time, Umar radiallahu anhu, pay attention to what he is talking. He's talking of Allah's ruling. Umar radiallahu anhu was such a brave man. Nothing could stop him but Allah and Allah's ruling. There Umar radiallahu anhu stood a while, and he pointed upon what he's talking about. Subhanallah. You have to say salam before you enter. You shouldn't be jumping over the fence, and you should. And if a person goes backbiting, he's hurting himself, he's losing his good deeds, he's hurting someone else's feeling. At the same time, Allah's curse will be befalling him, and it's as if eating the dead flesh of his own brother. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given a very stern warning. وَيْلٌ لِكُلِّ هُمَزَةٍ لُمَزَةٍ. We ask Allah to protect us from these sort of bad habits and guide us to the right path. We ask Allah refuge from his wile and from his the torments of his hellfire. May Allah save us all. May Allah forgive for us and for our parents and for all those who passed away from us. May Allah lighten their graves with the light of Quran. May Allah forgive their sins. May Allah admit them and ourselves in his paradise on the day of judgment. We are in the month of Rabi'ul Awwal, the month that has been blessed by the birth of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So I'm here to give you and to myself an advice that we we increasingly do a lot of salat and salam on Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and we would spend some time at least to learn about the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was the living Quran. Whatever Quran we are talking, he was the living, he was the walking Quran. And we do Mawlid Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is what, that is all of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, praising of Rasulullah. Inna Allah wa malaikatahu yusalluna ala al-Nabi. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu sallu alayhi wa sallimu taslima. Allah and all his angels are in constantly praising Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So believers, you also do so. So spend some time in your rooms and houses to read some of the hadith about Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and spend a lot of time invoking salat and salam. Man salla alayya salatan sallallahu alayhi biha ashra. Allahumma salli wa sallim mubarak ala rasulik sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Who invokes one salam upon Rasulullah, Allah will invoke upon them 10 salams. And أقربكم and those who will be drawn closer to Rasulullah on the day of judgment, and those will be eligible for the shafa'ah of the intercession of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, are only those who do increasingly salat and salam for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen, alhamdulillahi wa fi ni'amahu wa kafir mazidah. Allahumma salli ala sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala ali sayyidina Muhammadin wa barik wa sallim alayhi. اللهم صل صلاة كاملة وسلم سلاما تاما على سيدنا محمد الذي تنحل به العقد وتنفرج به الكرب وتقضى به الحوائج وتنال به الرغائب وحسن الخواتم ويستسقى الغمام بوجهه الكريم وعلى آله وصحبه في كل لمحة ونفس بعدد كل معلوم لك. اللهم اغفر لنا اللهم اغفر لنا اللهم اغفر لنا وارحمنا وعافنا واعف عنا. اللهم اشفنا واشف مرضانا وعاف مبتلانا ارحمنا وارحم موتانا. اللهم ارحم موتى المسلمين. اللهم اغفر للمؤمنين والمؤمنات المسلمين والمسلمات الاحياء منهم والاموات. اللهم ارزقنا شفاعة رسولك سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. اللهم ارزقنا في الدنيا زيارته وفي الاخرة شفاعته واشرنا تحت ظل لوائه المعقود. اللهم اجعلنا من خيار امته ومن محبيه يا رب العالمين. امين برحمتك يا ارحم الراحمين. وصلى الله تعالى وسلم على خير خلق سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين. From next week onwards, inshallah, this lesson is going to be on Saturday, straight after Maghrib until Isha. Then after Isha, we'll continue our Malayalam Quran lesson, inshallah. So both going to be on the same same days, inshallah. So just remind anyone who is not here, who used to come here, you know, it's going to be on Saturday after Maghrib. So it's going to be 11th of February, going to be around 6:30, inshallah. We will pray here Maghrib in the nearby mosque, then we stop until Isha. And after Isha, we'll carry on the lesson in Malayalam, inshallah. Wa akhu da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.